And now we'd like to welcome Karen from the Seneca Park Zoo to the show. Hi, Karen.
Hello.
Hi, Karen. Looks like you got your hands full.
Oh, yeah.
What did you bring to us today?
So this is Garret. He is a Burmese python. In fact, he is a juvenile. Okay. So for anyone who's been to the Seneca Park Zoo before, he is actually the juvenile, the offspring of our two really big snakes at the zoo. So they are called Abby and Mr. Slithers, and they are in the Eco Center in the middle of the room.
Okay.
So we have a lot of fun naming our snakes here.
Cool. So how old is Garret, and how old can they live to be?
So Garret was hatched about a year and a half ago. So they can generally live, Burmese pythons, around 15 to 25 years.
In nature? Or
In nature, yeah.
Wow.
But in conservation care, they can usually live longer. So by conservation care, I mean zoos, aquariums, and other conservation centers that give them good medical attention and just good care overall.
Nice.
Now, you said he's a year and a half, so he's really just a baby. Mm-hmm. How large is he going to go when he gets full grown?
Oh, good question. So these guys can get to be pretty big. So in terms of how big they can be around 70 to 100 pounds.
Wow.
However, there have been some Burmese pythons that are around 200 pounds.
Wow.
So they can get to be very big animals.
That is big, yeah.
Now you've made me afraid of it.
Right. So how do these animals hunt, and what are they going to be eating?
All right, so these guys are what we call ambush predators.
All right.
So what that means is they wait for the prey to come to them, and when the prey comes, that's when they lunge out and they grab the prey. So Garret here is not venomous.
Okay.
Instead, he is a constrictor.
Okay.
What that means is he will grab onto the prey with these sharp hook-like teeth, and then he's going to grab onto them, he's going to wrap his body all around, and it's going to squeeze very tightly.
Okay.
Now, it used to be that we thought that this would cause suffocation.
Right.
And that's how the animal would pass away. However, recent studies have suggested that what happens is actually a heart attack.
Really?
So that was a really quick way of actually killing their prey.
Interesting.
So
wow.
They determined that it's probably a heart attack instead. And so that's how he would
instead
catch his food
instead of suffocation.
Yep,
I think I'd have a heart attack if one of those wrapped around
me.
I don't know.
You had a 200-pound snake, right?
Where are they typically found?
So these guys are found in a wide range of habitats, ranging from forests to wetlands, all the way to rocky foothills. And they span all the way from India to China, all the way across Southeast Asia.
Very cool.
However, there has been quite a bit of habitat loss that's pushed them, because of human encroachment, that's pushed them to human areas, and they've adapted pretty well to those human areas, such as suburbia. And especially they can adapt pretty well as long as there is water nearby.
Cool. Now, he's wrapped up around your hand pretty well. Do they climb trees very well?
So when they're a juvenile, like Garret is here, they do spend most of their time up in the trees. As you'll notice, he has these beautiful color and patterns on him, and those colors really blend in with the bark and the leaves of the tree. Now, his snake appearance right here also blends in with the twigs of the tree.
Nice.
So he's very linear, like the twigs of the tree there. Now, you can imagine for a snake this size, a lot of animals might want to turn him into a snack.
Sure.
So that's why he needs to spend most of his time up in the trees.
Gotcha.
To make sure he can hide from predators there. We call that camouflage.
Yes.
Now, by the time they get to be those really big adult Burmese pythons, you can find them occasionally in the trees, but they do spend most of their time on the ground just because of their sheer size.
All right.
Okay, so now you made the comment that they have learned how to live in suburbia near people as long as they're near water.
Yeah.
Is it true they're good swimmers?
Indeed. So these guys are very comfortable with water, and they're pretty dependent on water as well, because they do have to submerge themselves quite a bit in order to start the shedding process.
Oh.
So they do shed quite a bit because they can get very big.
Okay, so with the water, why does that aid in the shedding part? Because we've heard other snakes, they rub against things to help with the shedding.
So each snake is different in terms of why he needs a wire to help him shed. That kind of loosens up the outside layer of his scales there, and the water helps him to do that. So that helps to shed all the skin off.
Very cool.
And
sort of like when you get pruny fingers because you've been in the water too much.
Right.
Yeah, that's a good comparison right there. And actually, their scales are made out of the same stuff as our fingernail.
Right,
so
keratin.
That's a pretty good comparison right there. Now, they also spend quite a bit of water, so they can actually hold their breath for up to 30 minutes underwater.
That's
how comfortable they can be inside of water.
Cool. Wow. So what can we do to help with this species or the snakes?
So a big problem going on right now, I mentioned that they can do very well around water.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. And that's why you can actually find them in marshes or wetlands, for example, in the Everglades right now. They are so comfortable in the water that sometimes they get so big that owners, they'll try to get them as pets. But then oftentimes they'll walk into these pet stores and they'll get them when they're this small, not realizing how big they're going to be.
Right.
So sometimes they realize they can't take care of such a large animal, and they'll release them out in nature. So if you do this in the Everglades is warm enough and wet enough that these guys can thrive.
All right.
And so when they thrive in those areas, they become what we call an invasive species.
Yes.
So invasive species, they can cause a lot of change, a lot of negative change to the ecosystem. These guys in the Everglades will outcompete the predators. They'll eat the local prey.
Sure.
And it has a negative consequence to a lot of the local populations of the animals that live there. So a very good way that we can help with that problem is just do a little research before we decide what animal we want to get.
As a pet.
Right. So first of all, can it fit your lifestyle?
Right.
How big is it going to get? Because even though he might look small right now,
it's not going to
be. He's going to get very big.
200 pounds.
Right. 200 pounds.
It's probably better not to get them as a pet. It's better to let the zoos have them and the aquarium so that we can come and look at them. Mm-hmm. You know how to take care of them.
And a big concern, too, as well, is you want to make sure you get them from a reputable source.
Sure.
So you never want to take animals, whether it be a snake or a bird or a lizard, that was taken out in nature.
Right.
Because then you're affecting their population out in nature. So you want to get them from, for example, a reputable breeder, just not out in nature.
Cool.
Sounds great. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Okay, if you would like to learn more about the Seneca Park Zoo and see other videos about animals, visit our website, homeworkhotline.org. And now, stay right there. We'll be back in a second.